Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents One World Now, The Ethics of Globalization, by Peter Singer, narrated by Matthew Lloyd Davis. Preface. In 2000, in the wake of the protests against the World Trade Organization that disrupted the ministerial meeting held in Seattle the previous December, I began work on a book that would become One World. My goal was to examine ethical aspects of the way in which the world was, and was not, becoming a global community. I had not got far before George W. Bush became President of the United States, bringing with him an administration overtly hostile to global institutions, from the United Nations to the International Criminal Court, and to the Kyoto Protocol, which was the first attempt to stop or mitigate climate change by a binding international agreement to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Then, on September 11, 2001, while I was putting the final touches to my draft, I watched, together with shocked students and faculty at Princeton University, while the World Trade Center towers burned and collapsed. The notion of one world suddenly sounded a discord against the resonating talk of a clash of civilizations. Nevertheless, the terrorist attack on that day and America's response to it confirmed the idea of a world that was increasingly becoming one, for it showed that no country, however mighty, is invulnerable to deadly force from the far corners of the earth. An American administration that had previously shown little concern for the opinion of the rest of the world found itself in need of the cooperation of other nations in a global campaign against terrorism, even if later it spurned global institutions in unleashing, without the approval of the United Nations Security Council, the misguided and ultimately disastrous invasion of Iraq. So I retained the original title, leaving it to stand both as a description of the increasing interconnectedness of life on this planet, and as a prescription of what the basic unit for our ethical thinking should be. One World reached a wide audience, both inside and outside colleges and universities. But the world has changed again since 2002. It is time to take a fresh look at globalization, including climate change, the global economy, international law, and global poverty. Hence, One World Now, a book that retains the basic structure and, in revised and updated form, some of the contents of One World, but takes account of major new developments, including the failure to reach an internationally binding post-Kyoto agreement on reducing greenhouse gas emissions, and the new approach taken by the non-binding agreement achieved in Paris in 2015. The declining influence of the World Trade Organization as a result of the failure of its Doha round of trade negotiations. The emergence and acceptance of the view that the world community has a responsibility to protect citizens of states when their government either cannot or will not protect them from crimes against humanity or genocide. The progress made in reducing extreme poverty, which, although substantial, leaves much still to be done, and the sharp rise in the number of refugees and internally displaced people desperate to find a safer place to live. An invitation to give the Terry Lectures at Yale University in 2000 was the stimulus to begin work on One World. I thank the Dwight H. Terry Lecture Committee, Robert Adams, Robert Apfel, Radley Daly, Carlos Eyre, Leo Hickey, John Ryden, Diane Vitter, and Richard Wood, for selecting me for this honour. The audience at Yale provided me with my first sounding board, and I then benefited from more detailed scrutiny and assistance from many wonderfully knowledgeable and helpful friends and colleagues. Paula Castle and Brent Howard read and commented on the entire draft of One World, and Matt Ball, John Broom, Michael Doyle, Gareth Evans, Nir Eyal, Peter Godfrey Smith, Axel Gosseris, Laurie Gruen, Dale Jameson, Andy Cooper, Vivian Levin, Stephen Macedo, Jonathan Marks, Daryl McLeod, Branko Milanovic, Nick Owen, Thomas Pogge, Leif Wenar, and Melissa Williams. All gave me comments on specific chapters within their various areas of expertise. Aaron Jackson and Diego von Vachano provided excellent research assistance, while Kim Gurman, my assistant, cheerfully and efficiently completed the many tasks I gave her. At Yale University Press, Jean Thompson Black was a consistently helpful and supportive editor. In writing One World Now, I was assisted by all those who over the years gave me constructive comments on One World, too many to list, even if I could remember them all. I will, however, mention John Huss, who has for many years been using One World in the honors section of his Introduction to Ethics course at the University of Akron. He tried out the draft chapters of the present book on his class and gave me feedback, with additional comments coming from his teaching assistant, Nevin Johnson, and students, Sarek Bell, Joe Klein, and Nathan Nicholas. Gareth Evans kindly read the section in Chapter 4 relating to the responsibility to protect, and his comments enabled me to improve this section. Yale University Press's anonymous reviewers made helpful suggestions that saved me from several errors. Princeton University, and more specifically, the University Center for Human Values, have, over many years, given me ideal conditions for research and writing. Amy Gutman, George Katib, Stephen Macedo, Alan Patton, and Chuck Bites all served as director of the center during the writing of One World or One World Now, and I thank them for their support. Students in my practical ethics course have been a critical audience for some of the material in this book. One World Now was completed in Australia, and I thank the School of Historical and Philosophical Studies at the University of Melbourne for providing me with an office and a congenial atmosphere for work. Finally, I thank Renata, my wife. Her love and companionship have added immeasurably to my life and work, and her readiness for adventure made it possible for us to try a new life in the United States. This book is one outcome of that decision. Peter Singer, University Center for Human Values, Princeton University, and School of Historical and Philosophical Studies, University of Melbourne. 1. A Changing World. Do our fellow citizens always come first? Consider two aspects of globalization. First, the ability of people living in Afghanistan, Iraq, or Yemen to bring sudden death and terror to New York, London, Madrid, Paris, and Sydney. And second, the emission of greenhouse gases from power stations, vehicles, and even cattle. The former leaves unforgettable images that are watched on television screens all over the world. The other causes changes to the climate of our planet in ways that can be detected only by scientific instruments. Yet both are indications of the way in which we are now one world. And the more subtle changes to which our vehicle exhausts contribute are already killing far more people than the highly visible deeds of terrorists. Over the decades since the 1980s, as scientists piled up the evidence that continuing greenhouse gas emissions will imperil hundreds of millions, perhaps billions of lives, state leaders struggled to agree on a plan for making sufficient cuts in those emissions to prevent a serious risk of climate becoming catastrophic, although such a plan would clearly be in the interests of the world as a whole. As we shall see later in this book, even the agreement reached in Paris in 2015 does not do enough. The lack of the necessary global perspective was never better illustrated than by George W. Bush. As President of the United States, the country that has, by its emissions over the past century, done more than any other to make climate change a problem, he said, "We will not do anything that harms our economy, because first things first are the people who live in America." That remark was not an aberration, but an expression of an ethical view that too many political leaders take for granted. His father, the first President George Bush, had said much the same thing at the 1992 Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro, when representatives of developing countries asked the president to put on the agenda the overconsumption of resources by the developed countries, especially the United States. George H.W. Bush said, "The American lifestyle is not up for negotiation." It was not negotiable, apparently. Even if maintaining this lifestyle will lead to the deaths of millions of people subject to increasingly unpredictable weather, and the loss of land used by tens of millions more people because of rising ocean levels and local flooding. But it is not only the two Bush administrations that put the interests of Americans first. In the early 1990s, in the context of the debate over whether to intervene in Bosnia to stop Serb ethnic cleansing operations directed against Bosnian Muslims, Colin Powell, then chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff under President Bill Clinton, quoted with approval Otto von Bismarck's remark that all the Balkans were not worth the bones of a single one of his soldiers. Bismarck, however, was not thinking of intervening in the Balkans to stop crimes against humanity. As Chancellor of Imperial Germany, he assumed that his country followed its national interest. To use his remark as an argument against humanitarian intervention was to return to 19th century power politics, ignoring both the bloody wars that style of politics brought about in the first half of the 20th century, and the efforts in the second half of the 20th century to find a better foundation for peace and the prevention of crimes against humanity. In Kosovo, though the Clinton administration's policy of giving absolute priority to American lives did not prevent intervention to defend the Kosovars, it led to the restriction of intervention to aerial bombardment. This strategy was a total success. NATO forces suffered not a single casualty in combat. Approximately 300 Kosovar, 209 Serb, and 3 Chinese civilians were killed. President Barack Obama used a similar air power-only strategy against the Islamic State, or ISIS, after 2014, when it was threatening to overrun Iraq. Again, this strategy avoids American casualties, but, as Ivan Eland pointed out, if the US uses only air power, ISIS will eventually hide in the cities and the US will be faced with causing a lot of civilian casualties to get the group out or kill its fighters. Observing the American reliance on air power to protect the people of Kosovo, Timothy Garton Ash wrote, "It is a perverted moral code that will allow a million innocent civilians of another race to be made destitute, because you are not prepared to risk the life of a single professional soldier of your own." This does not mean that putting boots on the ground is always a good thing to do. The American invasion of Iraq in 2003 brought about the regional chaos in which ISIS has thrived. It also, according to an estimate by researchers at Johns Hopkins University, caused 654,000 more Iraqi deaths than would have been expected under pre-war conditions. Nevertheless, Ash's comment raises a fundamental ethical issue. To what extent should political leaders see their role as limited to promoting the interests of their citizens? And to what extent should they be concerned with the welfare of people everywhere? As Ash suggests, there is a strong ethical case for saying that it is wrong for leaders to give absolute priority to the interests of their own citizens. The value of the life of an innocent human being does not vary according to nationality. But, it might be said, the abstract ethical idea that all humans are entitled to equal consideration cannot govern the duties of a political leader. Just as parents are expected to provide for the interests of their children rather than for the interests of strangers, so too anyone accepting the office of President of the United States takes on a specific role that makes it his or her duty to protect and further the interests of Americans. Other countries have their leaders, with similar roles in respect of the interests of their fellow citizens. There is no world government, and as long as that situation prevails, we must have sovereign states, and the leaders of those states must give preference to the interests of their citizens. Otherwise, unless electors were suddenly to turn into altruists of a kind never before seen on a large scale, democracy could not function. American voters would not elect a president who gave no more weight to their interests than he or she gave to the interests of Iraqis or Afghans. Our leaders feel they must give some degree of priority to the interests of their own citizens. And they are, so this argument runs, right to do so. Beyond a world of sovereign states. Is the division of the world into sovereign states a dominant and unalterable fact of life? Here our thinking has been affected by the horrors of Bosnia, Rwanda, and Kosovo. In Rwanda, a United Nations inquiry took the view that 2,500 military personnel, given the proper training and mandate, might have saved 800,000 lives. Kofi Annan, who was UN Undersecretary-General for peacekeeping operations at the time, must bear some responsibility for what the inquiry termed a terrible and humiliating paralysis, learn from this situation, and when he became Secretary General, urged that the world cannot stand aside when gross and systematic violations of human rights are taking place. What we need, he said, are legitimate and universal principles on which we can base intervention. Subsequently, as we shall see in more detail in Chapter 4, the United Nations World Summit unanimously accepted that the world community has a responsibility to protect the citizens of any state from genocide, ethnic cleansing, war crimes, and crimes against humanity. Even if this means military intervention against a government that is carrying out such crimes within its own territory. The British historian Martin Gilbert called the acceptance of this responsibility the most significant adjustment to sovereignty in 360 years. In other words, since the Treaty of Westphalia ended the 30 Years' War in Europe and established the principle of state sovereignty and non-intervention in the affairs of other states in 1648. How terrorism has weakened state sovereignty. In a very different manner, the aftermath of the terrorist attacks on the World Trade Center and the Pentagon in 2001 underlined the extent to which our thinking about state sovereignty has changed over the past century. More than a century ago, in the summer of 1914, another act of terrorism shocked the world. The assassination by a Bosnian Serb nationalist of Crown Prince Franz Ferdinand of Austria and his wife in Sarajevo. In the wake of that outrage, Austria-Hungary presented an ultimatum to Serbia in which it laid out the evidence that the assassins were trained and armed by the Black Hand, a shadowy Serbian organization headed by the chief of Serbian military intelligence. The Black Hand was tolerated or supported by Serbian government officials who arranged safe passage across the border into Bosnia for the seven conspirators in the assassination plot. Accordingly, Austria-Hungary's ultimatum demanded that the Serbs bring those responsible to justice and allow Austro-Hungarian officials to inspect the files to ensure that this had been done properly. Despite the clear evidence of the involvement of Serbian officials in the crime, evidence that historians agree was substantially accurate, the ultimatum Austria-Hungary presented to Serbia was widely condemned in Russia, France, Britain, and the United States. The most formidable document I have ever seen addressed by one state to another that was independent, the British Foreign Minister Sir Edward Grey called it. The American Legion's official history of the Great War used less diplomatic language, referring to the ultimatum as a vicious document of unproven accusation and tyrannical demand. Many historians studying the origins of the First World War have condemned the Austro-Hungarian ultimatum, saying that it demanded more than one sovereign state may properly ask of another. They have added that the Austro-Hungarian refusal to negotiate after the Serbian government accepted many but not all of its demands is further evidence that Austria-Hungary, together with its backer, Germany, wanted an excuse to declare war on Serbia. Hence, they must bear the guilt for the outbreak of the war and the 9 million deaths that followed. Now consider the American response to the 2001 terrorist attacks which were orchestrated by Al-Qaeda, then based in Afghanistan. The demands made of the Taliban government of Afghanistan by the Bush administration in 2001 were scarcely less stringent than those put to Serbia in 1914. The main difference is that the Austro-Hungarians insisted on the suppression of hostile nationalist propaganda. Freedom of speech was not so widely regarded then as a human right. The United States, with its strong constitutional protection of freedom of speech, could hardly demand that the Taliban do something that would be unconstitutional in the United States. Yet the American demands, far from being condemned as a mere pretext for aggressive war, were endorsed as reasonable and justifiable by a wide-ranging coalition of states. When President George W. Bush said in speeches and press conferences after September 11, 2001, that he would not draw a distinction between terrorists and regimes that harbour terrorists, no ambassadors, foreign ministers, or United Nations representatives denounced this as a vicious doctrine or a tyrannical demand on other sovereign states. The Security Council broadly endorsed it in its resolution of September 28, 2001. It seems that world leaders now accept that every state has an obligation to every other state to suppress activities within its borders that might lead to terrorist attacks carried out in other countries, and that it is reasonable to go to war with a state that does not do so. That is a sign of how far the world has moved in the direction of becoming a global community. The Bosnian Serb conspirators had only to slip across the border between Serbia and Bosnia in order to reach their target. But terrorism is no longer local or even regional. The Al-Qaeda terrorists who flew planes into the World Trade Center and the Pentagon travelled much further. Most of them were citizens of Saudi Arabia. And ISIS has been promoting terrorism over the internet, encouraging its adherents to carry out attacks in the countries in which they live. Similarly, in 2015, the civil war in Syria became a problem for all of Europe, as immigrants crossed to Greece and made their way up through Europe. Shortly before the attacks of September 11, a United Nations panel issued a report pointing out that even if there were no altruistic concern among the rich to help the world's poor, their own self-interest should lead them to do so. In the global village, someone else's poverty very soon becomes one's own problem. Of lack of markets for one's products, illegal immigration, pollution, contagious disease, insecurity, fanaticism, terrorism. Thus, the combination of terrorism, mass international travel, and the internet has made our world an integrated community in a new and frightening way. Not merely the activities of our neighbours, but also those of the inhabitants of the most remote mountain valleys of the farthest-flung countries of our planet are now potentially threatening, and so have become our concern. We need to extend the reach of the criminal law there and to have the means to bring terrorists to justice, without declaring war on an entire country in order to do so. For this, we need a sound global system of criminal justice, so justice does not become the victim of national differences of opinion. We also need, though it will be even more difficult to achieve, a sense that we really are one community, that we are people who recognize not only the force of prohibitions against killing each other, but also the pull of obligations to assist one another. This may not stop fanatics from carrying out suicide missions, but it will help to isolate them and reduce their support. It was not a coincidence that just 2 weeks after September 11, 2001, conservative members of the United States Congress abandoned their opposition to the payment of $582 million in back dues that the United States owed to the United Nations. When America was calling for the world to come to its aid to stamp out terrorism, it became apparent that America could no longer flout the rules of the global community to the extent that it had been doing before that fateful September morning. A new era for ethics and political theory. Implicit in the term globalization, rather than the older internationalization, is the idea that we are moving beyond the era of growing ties between states and are beginning to contemplate something more than the existing conception of state sovereignty. But this change needs to be reflected in all levels of our thought, especially in our thinking about ethics and our political theory. To see how much our thinking about ethics needs to change, consider the work that, better than any other, represents late 20th century thinking on justice in the liberal American establishment. John Rawls's A Theory of Justice. When I read it, shortly after its publication in 1971, I was astonished that a book with that title, nearly 600 pages long, could utterly fail to discuss the injustice of the extremes of wealth and poverty that exist between societies. Rawls' method is to seek the nature of justice by asking what principles people would choose if they were choosing in conditions that prevented them from knowing what position they themselves would occupy. That is, they must choose without knowing whether they themselves would be rich or poor, a member of the dominant ethnic majority or of an ethnic minority, a religious believer or an atheist, highly skilled or unskilled, and so on. If we were to apply this method globally rather than for a given society, it would immediately be obvious that one fact about which those making the choice should be ignorant is whether they are citizens of a rich country such as the United States or of a poor country such as Haiti. In setting up his original position, however, Rawls simply assumes that the people making the choice all belong to the same society and are choosing principles to achieve justice within their society. Hence, when he argues that people choosing under the conditions he prescribes would choose a principle that, subject to constraints intended to protect equal liberty and fair equality of opportunity, seeks to improve the position of the worst off, he limits the conception of worst off to those within one's own society. If he accepted that to choose justly, people must also be ignorant of their citizenship, his theory would become a forceful argument for improving the prospects of the worst-off people in the world. But in the most influential work on justice written in 20th century America, this question never even arises. Rawls addressed it late in his life in a short book, The Law of Peoples, and I shall say something later about what he says there. His approach, however, remains firmly based on the idea that the unit for deciding what is just remains something like today's nation-state. Rawls's model is that of an international order, not a global order. Most political theorists today still make that assumption, but there is now a growing minority who take a global perspective. Yael Tamir, who, having served in the Israeli parliament and as a government minister, cannot be dismissed as a mere academic remote from political reality, has called for political theorists to dare to ask the fundamental question: should the unity and autonomy of the sovereign state be retained, or should the state be transcended from some purposes and divided for others? Political theorists are now asking that question. As David Held and Pietro Maffetoni point out in their preface to a collection of essays by leading scholars working on global political theory, the acceleration of globalization since the 1980s fundamentally challenges the idea that normative political ideas can be confined to the internal life of states. Their volume is evidence that political theory is responding to this challenge and changing its nature as it does so. Technology changes almost everything. For most of the eons of human existence, people living only short distances apart may as well, for all the difference they made to each other's lives, have been living in separate worlds. A river, a mountain range, a stretch of forest or desert, a sea. These were enough to cut people off from each other. Over the past few centuries, the isolation has dwindled slowly at first, then with increasing rapidity. Now people living on opposite sides of the world are linked in ways previously unimaginable. 150 years ago, Karl Marx gave a one-sentence summary of his theory of history. The handmill gives you society with the feudal lord. The steam mill, society with the industrial capitalist. Today, he might have added, the jet plane, the telephone, and the internet give you a global society with the transnational corporation and the World Trade Organization. Technology changes everything. That was Marx's claim. And if it was a dangerous half-truth, it was still an illuminating one. As technology has overcome distance, economic globalization has followed. Planes can bring fresh vegetables from Kenya to compete in London supermarkets alongside those from nearby Kent. In the wrong hands, those planes can also become lethal weapons that bring down tall buildings. Instant digital communication spreads the nature of international trade from physical objects to skilled services. At the end of a day's trading, a bank based in New York may have its accounts balanced by clerks living in India. The increasing degree to which there is a single world economy is reflected in the development of new forms of global governance, the most controversial of which has been the World Trade Organization. But the WTO is not itself the creator of the global economy. Global market forces provide incentives for every country to put on what Thomas Friedman has called a golden straitjacket, a set of policies that involve freeing up the private sector of the economy, shrinking the bureaucracy, keeping inflation low, and removing restrictions on foreign investment. If a country refuses to wear the golden straitjacket or tries to take it off, then the electronic herd, the currency traders, stock and bond traders, and those who make investment decisions for multinational corporations, could gallop off in a different direction, taking with it the investment capital that countries want to keep their economy growing. When capital is internationally mobile, to raise your tax rates is to risk triggering a flight of capital to other countries with comparable investment prospects and lower taxation. The upshot is that as the economy grows and average income rise, the scope of politics may shrink, at least as long as no political party is prepared to challenge the assumption that global capitalism is the best economic system. When neither the government nor the opposition is prepared to take the risk of removing the golden straitjacket, the differences between the major political parties shrink to differences over minor ways in which the straitjacket might be adjusted. Thus, even without the WTO, the growth of the global economy itself marks a decline in the power of the nation-state. The difficulty of challenging international economic arrangements was vividly demonstrated by the gap between the anti-austerity rhetoric used by the Greek leftist party, Syriza, in its January 2015 election campaign, and the actions taken by Syriza in government when faced with an ultimatum from Greece's creditors. Marx argued that in the long run we never reject advances in the means by which we satisfy our material needs. Hence, history is driven by the growth of productive forces. He would have been contemptuous of the suggestion that globalization is something foisted on the world by a conspiracy of corporate executives meeting at the World Economic Forum in Davos. And he might have agreed with Friedman's remark that the most basic truth about globalization is, no one is in charge. For Marx, however, the significance of this statement is not that conspiracy theorists are wrong, though he would have agreed that they are wrong, but that we are living in an alienated world in which instead of ruling ourselves, we are ruled by our own creation, the global economy. For Friedman, on the other hand, all that needs to be said about Marx's alternative, state control of the economy, is that it doesn't work. Marx also believed that a society's ethic is a reflection of the economic structure to which its technology has given rise. Thus, a feudal economy in which serfs are tied to their lord's land gives you the ethic of feudal chivalry based on the loyalty of knights and vassals to their lord and the obligations of the lord to protect them in time of war. A capitalist economy requires a mobile labour force able to meet the needs of the market. So it breaks the tie between lord and vassal, substituting an ethic in which the right to buy and sell labour is paramount. Our newly interdependent global society, with its remarkable possibilities for linking people around the planet, gives us the material basis for a new ethic. Marx would have thought that such an ethic will serve the interests of the ruling class, that is, the rich countries and the transnational corporations they have spawned. Marx wanted to bring our ethical judgments down to earth. They did not, he thought, come from God or from reason, but from the economic basis of our society and the means we use to produce the goods we consume. He did not consider a different earthly possibility, that our ethical judgments have a biological basis in our origins as social mammals. The intuitive responses by which we judge many things to be right or wrong have their origins in the behaviour and feelings of our human and pre-human ancestors, and were suited for life in a small group in which everyone knew everyone else. That is very far from the world in which we live today. But many of our deepest moral intuitions persist. One of the themes of this book will be the way in which they need to change if we are to overcome the problems the world faces. The fact that many of our moral intuitions stem from our ancestors' need to survive and reproduce in conditions in which they lived does not mean that our reasoning abilities are powerless to reshape our ethics. If the group to which we must justify ourselves is the tribe or the nation, then our morality is likely to be tribal or national. If, however, the revolution in communications has created a global audience, we may feel a need to justify our behaviour to the whole world. That is the approach to ethics that frames the chapters that follow. It would be naive to believe that the existence of the internet and the enhanced possibilities of communication across national boundaries that come with it would be sufficient to bring about a new ethic that will serve the interests of all those who live on this planet in a way that, despite much rhetoric, no previous ethic has ever done. The second decade of the 21st century has seen a resurgence of nationalism in China, resulting in disputes with Japan, Vietnam and the Philippines over the ownership of small islands in the East and South China Seas. Similarly, in Russia, stronger nationalism led to the occupation of Crimea and support for pro-Russian rebels in eastern Ukraine. Nevertheless, the existence of a global audience and a global discussion would seem to be a necessary, though not sufficient, condition for a truly global ethic. If this appeal to our need for ethical justification appears to be based on too generous a view of human nature and of the ability of reasoning to influence our ethical judgments and our behaviour, there is another consideration of a very different kind that leads in the same direction. The great empires of the past, whether Persian, Roman, Chinese or British, were, as long as their power lasted, able to keep their major cities safe from the threat of those they considered barbarians on the frontiers of their far-flung realms. The Persians and Romans kept them out by the strength of their armies, the British prevailed by their supremacy on the seas, and the Chinese built the Great Wall. In the 21st century, the greatest superpower in history was unable to keep the self-appointed warriors of a different worldview from attacking both its financial centre and its capital. The thesis of this book is that how well we come through the era of globalisation, perhaps whether we come through it at all, will depend on how we respond ethically to the idea that we live in one world. For the rich countries not to take a global ethical viewpoint has long been seriously morally wrong. Now it is also, in the long term, a danger to their security. 2. One atmosphere. The problem. There can be no clearer illustration of the need for human beings to act globally than the issues raised by the impact of human activity on our atmosphere. That we all share the same planet came to our attention in a particularly pressing way in the 1970s. When scientists discovered that the use of chlorofluorocarbons, CFCs, threatened the ozone layer shielding the surface of our planet from the full force of the sun's ultraviolet radiation. Damage to that protective shield would cause cancer rates to rise sharply and could have other effects, for example, on the growth of algae. The threat to people living in the world's southernmost cities was especially acute, since a large hole in the ozone was found to be opening up each year over Antarctica. In the long term, the entire ozone shield was imperiled. Once the science was accepted, concerted international action followed relatively rapidly, with the signing of the Montreal Protocol in 1987. The developed countries phased out virtually all use of CFCs by 1999, and the developing countries, given a 10-year period of grace, achieved the same goal in time for the 25th anniversary of the treaty in 2012. Getting rid of CFCs turned out to be just the opening act. The main event is climate change. Not to belittle the pioneering achievement of those who brought about the Montreal Protocol, but the problem they faced was not so difficult, for CFCs can be replaced in all their uses at relatively little cost. And the solution to the problem is simply to stop producing them. Climate change is a very different matter. The scientific evidence that human activities are changing the climate of our planet has been studied by a working group of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, an international scientific body established to provide policymakers with an authoritative view of climate change and its causes. The group released its fifth assessment report in 2014, building on earlier reports and incorporating new evidence accumulated over the 5 years since the previous report. The report is the work of more than 800 authors. The section on the physical science basis of climate change alone is over 2,000 pages long and draws on 9,200 peer-reviewed scientific publications. Like any scientific document, it is open to criticism from other scientists, but it reflects a broad consensus of leading scientific opinion, and is by far the most authoritative view available on what is happening to our climate. The fifth assessment report finds that the evidence is unequivocal that since the 1950s, the atmosphere and oceans have warmed, glaciers have shrunk, the Greenland and Antarctic ice sheets have been losing mass, Arctic sea ice is diminishing, and sea levels are rising at an increasingly rapid rate. At the Earth's surface, each of the past three decades has been successively warmer than any preceding decade since 1850. The year 2014 was the hottest, until 2015 broke that record too. The 10 hottest years on record since reliable global records began in 1880 have occurred since 1998. And 13 of the 14 hottest years on record have occurred in the 21st century. One way of indicating how the world's climate has changed within the lifespan of people like me, who were born in the mid-20th century, is this. If you were born after 1985, you have never experienced even a single month in which the global temperature was below the 20th century average for that month. Paralleling these changes, there has been an increase in concentrations of carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide in the atmosphere, produced by human activities such as the burning of fossil fuels, the clearing of vegetation, and, in the case of methane, cattle and rice production. These gases are now at levels unprecedented in the last 800,000 years. In addition, the increased amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has caused the oceans to become more acidic. How much of the change in climate has been produced by human activity, and how much can be explained by natural variation? The fifth assessment report finds that it is extremely likely that human influence has been the dominant cause of the observed warming since the mid-20th century. In the language of the report, extremely likely indicates a probability in the range of 95 to 100%. Those of us who have no expertise in the scientific aspects of assessing climate change and its causes can scarcely disregard the views held by the overwhelming majority of those who do possess that expertise. Even if all of them were in agreement, it would still be possible that they are wrong. But in view of what is at stake, to rely on that possibility would be playing Russian roulette with hundreds of millions and possibly billions of lives at stake. Those who are sceptical about the science of climate change must, if they are intellectually honest, admit that there is a significant chance that the overwhelming majority of scientists have got it right. And if that is the case, they should ask themselves whether it is right to take no action and thus to run that risk. What is likely to happen if we continue on our present course with increasing amounts of greenhouse gases going into the atmosphere? In the absence of substantial and sustained reductions in greenhouse gas emissions, we will, according to the fifth assessment report, see further warming and other changes in all aspects of our planet's climate. Relative to the period 1986 to 2005, which was, as we have heard, already warmer than any previous decades since 1850, global mean surface temperatures in the decades of 2046 to 65, when many listeners of this book will still only be middle-aged, are expected to rise between 1 and 2 degrees Celsius, with a range of 0.4 degrees Celsius to 2.6 degrees Celsius. Although these average figures may seem quite small, whether tomorrow is going to be 20 degrees Celsius, 69 degrees Fahrenheit, or 22 degrees Celsius, 72 degrees Fahrenheit, isn't such a big deal. Even a 1 degree Celsius rise in average temperatures would be greater than any change that has occurred in a single century for the past 10,000 years, and would be enough to pose a risk to global and regional food security, as well as to threaten to cause the extinction of many species that will be unable to adapt. High temperatures and humidity could make normal human activities, such as growing food and working outdoors, impossible in some now habitable regions for a part of each year. Moreover, some regional changes will be more extreme and are much more difficult to predict. Northern landmasses, especially North America and Central Asia, will warm more than the oceans or coastal regions. Precipitation will increase overall. But there will be sharp regional variations, with some areas that now receive adequate rainfall becoming arid. There will also be greater year-to-year fluctuations than at present, with more intense El Niño effects in the Pacific Ocean, so we can expect droughts and floods to be more severe. The Asian summer monsoon is likely to become less reliable. It is possible that the changes could be enough to reach critical tipping points at which the weather systems alter or the directions of major ocean currents like the Gulf Stream change. If the Gulf Stream were to disappear, average winter temperatures in Britain would drop about 5 degrees Celsius, and significant drops would occur across Western Europe as well. Finally, warming oceans will cause the melting of ice sheets in Antarctica and Greenland, which will in turn cause sea levels to rise. The fifth assessment report predicts a rise in the range of 0.52 to 0.98 metres, 1.5 to 3 feet, by 2100. Although, as we shall see, some scientists consider this figure to be too conservative. If warming continues, sea levels are expected to rise by at least 7 metres, and possibly as much as 13 metres, that's between 22 and 42 feet, perhaps as soon as 2150. What will the consequences be for humans? The following impacts are already occurring and will increase in severity during the remainder of the 21st century. As oceans become warmer, hurricanes and tropical storms that have largely been confined to the tropics are moving further from the equator, hitting large urban areas that have not been built to cope with them. Tropical diseases are spreading beyond their previous zones. Food production will rise in some regions, especially in the high northern latitudes, and fall in others, including sub-Saharan Africa. Rising sea levels are beginning to threaten low-lying coastal regions, including low-lying Pacific islands, fertile delta regions, and some of the world's most densely populated cities. How much of this change is already happening? Several highly publicized hurricanes, droughts, and floods have been attributed to climate change. But for any individual extreme weather event, it is difficult to say that without climate change it would not have occurred. It's like car accidents. If you drive faster, you are more likely to have a serious accident. But any particular accident.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.